Good afternoon. I'm Warren Hogue, IPI's Senior Advisor for External Relations, and I'm happy to welcome you here. And let me begin by apologizing for the fact that I have to leave right after these brief remarks, but I didn't want to miss out on greeting Hilde Johnson in what is now her fourth appearance at IPI in the past 5 years. After the last one in July of 2014, I told her, when you finish the book, let us know and we'll invite you back. So welcome back, Hilde. And thanks for keeping IPI up to date with the albeit distressing developments in South Sudan, the creation of which, as the United Nations' newest member state in July of 2011, led to great elation in this UN community, if the events since then have led to repeated despair. Hilde first came here earlier in 2011 to talk about her book, Waging Peace in Sudan, the inside story of the negotiations that ended Africa's longest civil war. Though she was at the time the deputy executive director of UNICEF, right next door, as Norway's Minister of International Development, she had been deeply involved in the negotiations behind the Comprehensive Peace Agreement of 2005 that ended 22 years of a north-south war in Sudan that had killed an estimated 2 million people. By her next visit in March of 2013, she had become the special representative of the Secretary General and head of the UN mission in the Young Republic of South Sudan, and had already witnessed the outbreak of a disastrous conflict just months before, which was to shatter any hopes of an inspirational birth of a nation. In addition to speaking to an SRSG series gathering here that time, she was interviewed for IPI's Global Observatory website. By the time she was next here, in July of 2014, she was finishing up her tour in Juba, a disturbing period of time in which she had seen the UN mission dramatically have to shift from prevention to direct response, with some 100,000 civilians taking refuge in UN bases across the country. She also had witnessed the country's liberators, whom she knew well, turn on each other, triggering a horrific civil war in the adjoining country, with people's ethnic identities overwhelming any national one. In an effort to understand and explain how this could have possibly happened, she wrote a new book, South Sudan, The Untold Story from Independence to Civil War. And as promised, she has come here to talk about it. We also have excellent discussions to carry forward the conversation about South Sudan. Gaspar Martins, the permanent representative of Angola to the United Nations, and Ian Martin, the executive director of Security Council Report. And to guide the conversation as moderator, Sarah Cliff, director of New York University's Center on International Cooperation. But first, the author. And please join me in welcoming back to IPI, Hilde Johnson.
I was not expecting, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, that I would be standing here after a momentous decision has been made by the Security Council today. But let me just use this opportunity to really congratulate Antonio Guterres with an incredible choice today, a fantastic choice for SG, and one of the ones who supported me the most in the darkest and toughest of times in Juba. So I just wanted to convey that. You've got a Secretary General who is also seeing individuals in trouble. So that's good to know. I will start with a quote by Salva Kiir Mayardit on Independence Day. He said the following: "Our detractors have already written us off, even before the proclamation of our independence. They say we will slip into civil war as soon as our flag is hoisted. They justify that by arguing that we are incapable of resolving our problems through dialogue. They charge that we are quick to revert to violence. They claim that our concept of democracy and freedom is faulty. It is incumbent upon us to prove them all wrong. So far, Savaki Mayadit. 2 years later, the detractors were proven right, unfortunately. Competition for political power had turned violent and would eventually shake the foundations of the new country. Before its third birthday, the dream of independence and freedom had turned into a nightmare. The liberators risked destroying the very country they had spent decades fighting for. How could this happen? In the book I'm launching, South Sudan, the Untold Story from Independence to Civil War, now also available in the US, I'm trying to answer this question. As Minister of International Development for Norway, I was deeply involved in the negotiations that led to the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, CPA, in 2005 between the government of Sudan and the Sudan People's Liberation Movement and Army. After almost 5 decades, Africa's longest civil war had ended. The CPA did not grant the Southerners independence, but self-determination. The parties were giving unity a chance over an interim period of 6 years, after which Southern Sudan would have the right to hold a referendum on its own future. With the CPA, Southern Sudan had to go through 3 transitions, each extremely demanding. First, transition from war to peace for people who had known little but war was a major shift. Second, transition from liberation struggle to government was another. Third was the complex transition to independence. All 3 transitions were underway after Southern Sudan, South Sudan then it became, voted overwhelmingly for independence in January 2011. And later on Independence Day, 6 months later, July, when I took the helm as Special Representative and SRSG and Head of Mission. I'll walk us through those 3 transitions very quickly. First, transition from war to peace. South Sudan was separated from Sudan in 2011, before all the terms of the divorce had been reached. Relations between the neighbors were expected to be difficult, but few foretold bombing raids hitting refugee camps, occupation of oil fields, and a complete shutdown of oil production in South Sudan. This in turn affected all efforts of state building and peace building. At the same time, South Sudan had major internal security problems. The country's largest state, Jonglei, was mired in a cycle of intercommunal violence in which thousands of civilians had been killed. Protecting civilians in an area containing one of the largest swamps in the world when flooded, alone the size of England, was a tall order. We had only 4,000 infantry soldiers, approximately 1 soldier per 100 square kilometers. They were located in different parts of the country as civilians were under threat many places. We had to face ethnically mobilized columns in military formation of some 6,000 to 8,000 young men attacking civilians in large numbers. Our maximal deployment at one any point of time was 1/10 of this number. Jonglei was a microcosm testing the country's leadership and us in the UN. It was here we would face our greatest challenge prior to the December 2013 crisis and the civil war. But these problems were minor compared to later protection challenges. Second, the transition from liberation struggle to government. That was predictably difficult. The country was awash with weapons, mostly in civilian hands. Lack of commitment prevented necessary reform. This implied turning the liberation movement into a political party and the liberation force into a national army. Both processes stalled. The security sector was not reformed and contained tens of thousands of former militia which were poorly integrated into the army. Command and control was poor, corruption rampant, and inflation in rank a major problem. The SPLA had indeed 700 generals, probably per capita the highest number in Africa. Furthermore, the liberators failed to use the interim CPA period to strengthen the foundations on which the country could be built through stronger institutions. They also ignored numerous warnings against corruption and mismanagement. This liberation curse took hold where people felt entitled to power. It was their turn to eat. South Sudan was soon afflicted by the oil curse. Oil revenue became an irresistible temptation for carders who had spent most of their lives in the bush. Resources lubricated patronage networks, while significant amounts were simply siphoned away to foreign bank accounts. You'll find a lot of detail on these corruption scandals in the book. Instead of cleaning up, at the very least at independence, the liberators continued to eat and institutions remained weak. The third transition, the complex transition to independence, was therefore marked by continuity and very limited change. The people who expected to finally reap the fruits of peace and freedom saw their hopes dashed. They continued to wait for schools for their children, clinics for their sick, and roads to get to the markets. South Sudan ended up being by far the biggest spender of public funds in the region, per capita 3 times as much as Kenya and 4 times as much as Uganda. However, South Sudan spent 1/4 of their neighbors on education and 1/5 or 1/6 on health. It was more likely, and still is, that a teenage girl would die in childbirth than she will enter grade 8 at school. The money went elsewhere. It was ruled by the elite for the elite. Although attempts were made by the president to address the cancer of corruption in 2012, and we tried on our side in the mission to assist, they were not followed through. The liberation curse and the oil curse prevailed. This also implied that state institutions, including the army, were insufficiently developed to sustain the pressure of an escalating political crisis. Now to the crisis. The build-up started in the fall of 2012, and early attempts were made within the SPLM to engage with the two leaders, Salva Kiir and Riek Machar, informally. Later, in early 2013, a committee was formed, chaired by Deng Alor, the current foreign minister. Through a series of meetings, they tried to resolve the leadership crisis within the SPLM. These efforts came to a dead end. They couldn't do it. Eventually. From July 2013 onwards, regional leaders flew in to help. The Ethiopian foreign minister, the Kenyans and former President Thabo Mbeki and the AUHIP, South Africa's Cyril Ramaphosa and the ANC came. Also, other friends discreetly flew in and engaged with the leaders. We all did. That violence could occur was clear to many of us, but high-risk behavior from a number of leaders made everything worse. This included 3 important actions. 1, the total exclusion of factions of the SPLM from the new cabinet in 2013, followed by a political mobilization with public confrontation on all sides. Secondly, moves that could be interpreted as military preparation on both sides, including moving additional security forces to the capital, Dinka, outside the SPLA's normal structures. And not least, and this one was from the newer side, spinning of stories about arrests and disarmament in the last week before the National Liberation Council. That was the 3rd action. In the end, Juba was like a powder keg. It had spiraled like this. These series of actions contributed to what Barry Posen calls the security dilemma. Both sides took preemptive steps for their own protection, but ended up escalating the situation and triggered by the acts of a few reckless individuals, it spun out of control. The South Sudanese leaders played with fire and allowed a power struggle to put everything they had fought for at risk. They all ignored the warnings, both from my side and others, that this would lead to ethnic violence. The last trigger was Salva Kiir's speech at the National Liberation Council on 15 December 2013. The speed, the scale, and gravity of the violence that ensued shocked everyone, including the South Sudanese leaders themselves. The massive killings and massacres of Nuer on ethnic grounds in Juba triggered a response in kind. A shadowy group of people on the government side from the Dinka community of Bahr el Ghazal had conducted the military operations, systematically killing along ethnic lines. the wholesale revenge came as a groundswell from below, making it possible for Riek Machar to mount sizable opposition forces in record time. With the SPLA splitting along ethnic lines, joined by the white army of thousands, the opposition quickly reached numbers. These forces committed atrocities in equal measure. In other words, this was not a long-term plan, it was not a planned coup, and it was not a planned genocide. No one really planned a civil war either. But the responsibility for the civil war, its escalation, and the current mess we're in rests with the two leaders, Salva Kiir and Riek Machar. They had the opportunity to stop this senseless war a long time ago. They chose not to. And then the obvious question, what about the UN? Could we have done more? I'm sure the international community and I myself could have done more. Still, a lot was done. As early as 18 months before the crisis, I tried to organize events, retreats within the leadership to address both critical reform issues, SPLM reform, and the tensions in the leadership. All five of the top leaders individually agreed with me to do this, four times, last in February 2013, in the middle of the ensuing crisis. But in the end, it was not done. Through numerous discussions with the chairman of the SPLM committee, I pushed to bring in regional leaders to help resolve the crisis earlier, already from March 2013. However, they wanted to resolve the crisis by themselves. When the regional leaders finally came in, it was probably too late. Could the UN then have done more to stop the killings and massacres in Juba? During the last week of December, we had 150 soldiers that were not protecting our facilities. That's it. Our infantry battalions were elsewhere, in Jonglei, where civilians were seen to be most at risk, and we were expecting revenge attacks at that point. Our capacity to protect in Juba was close to zero. In the morning hours on 16 December, hundreds of civilians were gathering outside our gates, seeking protection from the violence. They were basically fleeing and running for their lives. At 7:30 a.m., I told our security to open the gates to our two bases in Juba to protect them. After this, thousands and thousands sought shelter with the UN bases. On that very day, 14,000. It was at a scale never seen before in the UN's history. Subsequently, anyone fleeing the violence, whether Nuer, Dinka, or foreigner, all over the country, all got refuge. The number reached over 140,000 during my time and has since reached more than 200,000, unfortunately. It was an absolute last resort and a decision fraught with problems. People have suffered under very bad conditions in the protection of civilian sites, yet their lives were saved. If we hadn't done it, most and many, many would be killed. Would I have done the same again, people have asked me, knowing what has happened, that they remained and didn't return home? My answer is yes, I would, because I would like to face the mirror the following morning. This did lead to increased tensions between the government and the UN, leading to demonstrations and personal attacks. But it was much worse for the people. The outrageous atrocities committed on both sides in equal measure are an abomination. Mass killings on ethnic grounds, the systematic use of sexual violence as a weapon of war, women and girls being gang raped and burnt alive in their dwellings, horrific crimes committed against children, including abduction, recruitment, castration, rape, and murder, boys as young as 10 mutilated, acts of violence that seem to be motivated as a generational attack on another ethnic group. The atrocities committed were beyond comprehension, the intransigence of the leaders appalling. It was as if people no longer mattered, and it is unprecedented in South Sudanese history. After 18 months of negotiations by IGAD, the South Sudanese leaders finally signed a peace agreement in August 2015, with Riek Machar returning only in April 2016 to establish the transitional government. The fundamental question we have all asked ourselves is this: can the same characters that caused the crisis now save South Sudan? We got a preliminary answer in July. South Sudan had just cancelled its independence celebrations for the fifth birthday. After only 10 weeks of joint government, fighting erupted in Juba, and hundreds, if not a thousand or more, were killed. Targeted killings took place again, and Riek Machar fled the capital. He was pursued by government security forces for weeks afterwards. South Sudan was once again plunged into the abyss. The country was already imploding from within. The social fabric was tearing apart. Human suffering now reached unprecedented levels. Starvation and hunger, forced displacement and violence, with conflicts almost all over the country. Blocking of humanitarian aid and protection forces, rule by the gun, with predatory behavior against innocent civilians by almost all security forces. And the list is longer. All of this committed by South Sudanese against South Sudanese. Half the population of South Sudan, 6.1 million, are now in need of aid. 2.6 million have fled their homes. It is the worst humanitarian crisis after Syria. The betrayal committed by the liberators against themselves and their people is unprecedented. I think the freedom fighters and the martyrs would have turned in their graves. In another ironic twist, Taban Dengai, from a faction of the opposition, was appointed first vice president, and the fate of the peace agreement was in question. At the same time, the Security Council decided to send a regional protection force of 4,000 soldiers to the capital and called for the establishment of the hybrid court for accountability. South Sudan urgently needs not only to be saved from fighting, it needs to be saved from failing and from falling apart. This was my assessment when the book went to print in April 2016. Now it is even more urgent. The country is in a downward spiral, and I believe we will see more ethnic violence if there isn't interventions to put the country on the right course. It is not long before developments in South Sudan will become irreversible. A rescue operation is needed. How? The peace agreement is the only game in town. Or is it? It has to be. It now has to be rescued and revitalized. It must be used as a basis for change. Here, three things are critical. Firstly, the actual and potential spoilers of peace must be stopped. This must imply that all signatories of the peace agreement must be part of the solution. Exclusion of any of them will create major spoilers and more fighting. Second, the peace agreement will have to be adjusted on the security arrangements and probably power sharing, hence be reviewed, but in that way rescued. Number three, some kind of inclusive roundtable of all the political forces of South Sudan should be convened, paving the way for a caretaker government. This should probably be combined with external management of certain sectors that are in peril at the moment. It is also in support of a clear political strategy that the regional protection force will yield results. Such a rescue operation will be needed for new leaders to take over. And as I say in the book, it is only the younger generation of South Sudanese leaders that can save South Sudan, not reinvented versions of 2.0 of the old ones. The young leaders are ready, and they should be given the chance. The sooner, the better. And as Archbishop Desmond Tutu reminds us in the foreword of the book, in the midst of all the darkness, believing in this change is our hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Hilde. I was in South Sudan at the initial period of the Comprehensive Peace Agreement, and then later in the week when the announcement on the shutdown of oil production was made. So I saw some of the very high hopes and dreams of the beginning of that period and how they were later dashed. And Hilde tells that story very, very well in the book. So we see, I think, how you go from this enormous momentum through a whole series of events to what we now see as the devastation of that agreement. And she knows, of course, the actors and those dynamics over a period of very many years. But in reading the book, I was struck by how much this is a very well-researched and well-analyzed book, also on the structural factors which led towards those risks. And I was struck reading it by the very unfortunate fact that the two newly independent states we have seen in the 21st century, South Sudan and Timor-Leste, both fell into fighting after their independence, and for a series of structural factors which are described very, very clearly in the book: weak institutions and low trust, a legacy of a mindset of war and resistance, high expectations on the one hand and very low capacity to deliver on the other. Timor-Leste, of course, has subsequently recovered and flourished, and that perhaps is a positive sign for South Sudan, but only after its leadership took really seriously and to heart the lessons that came out of the fighting on unity, on the need to build inclusive institutions, and change the direction in a way that was nationally driven. So I think going into this debate, there are unquestionably lessons that first and foremost, of course, go to national leadership and to the society of South Sudan itself in terms of the directions that need to be taken in the future. But there are also lessons for the international community. And there are some very clear points made in the book about things that perhaps could have been done more strongly, ways in which the international community could have aligned better to help the society of South Sudan minimize these risks. So I'm very pleased from that regard to be able to welcome our two commentators. First, Ambassador Gaspar Martins, who has, of course, a very deep knowledge of the dynamics of conflict in the region and the experiences of this type of situation. Ambassador Martins.
I thank you very much. I would like to start by saying that this is a very good moment to have the book that Hilde Johnson has brought to this audience, to the world audience, especially in Africa, and to that audience which is going to be responsible for rescuing the situation. I'm talking about the young generation. Look, you cannot have a country with two leaders, two armies, too many arms, as Hilde said, awash with guns. This has been one of our main efforts at the level of the United Nations to stop the selling of guns as toys to countries. When you have army, when you have, you know, guns, you have to use them. When you have too many, and you have people struggling to assure power and leadership as opposed to someone else, you have the kind of situation we have in South Sudan. Now, South Sudan is part of a region to which we are also part, Angola, the Great Lakes region. Let me say that we are just now preparing a Great Lakes summit in Angola just on the 21st of October to deal with the situation in South Sudan in addition to what has been done here at the level of the United Nations, Security Council particularly. Security Council, when we were preparing for that last mission to South Sudan to reinforce the need for the agreement which has just been signed, One of the situations which we saw was the need to really impose an arms embargo. This has not been done yet. There are reasons, but there is a need for it. Fortunately, right now, we do not have any more the two leaders, the two armies. This situation is being resolved, and I hope if we are all in on one, on the same page, we should be able to definitely impose not just an arms embargo, but at least a total control of the use of guns in the country. I think that a situation with 6.201 million people in need of humanitarian assistance, with the UN camps being targeted by the people with guns, rebels or whatever, that's not the situation in which we, I think, at the level of the Council should just treat it business as usual. I think we have to change. I think there is going to be a need for a greater ownership on the part of South Sudan. If that does not exist, we cannot deal with situation like South Sudan. National ownership is major. Let me give you our example. Actually, two examples. Let me deal with a situation like DRC. I was a boy, 21 years old, when I ran out of my country under colonialism then to go to Congo to join forces for those we were fighting for our independence with the support of international community, some of the international community. Today, DRC still has a peacekeeping operation, one of the largest peacekeeping operations. Why? National ownership. Let me give you now the example of Angola. We in Angola, we took it that the solution for the problems of Angola has to come from Angolans, younger and elder ones, but coming together with the examples and lessons being passed to others. I remember when we first joined the Security Council, it was my responsibility to come and then announce to the Council that we did not need a UN peacekeeping operation to stay on, that we had to take our own responsibilities. That is what South Sudan needs to do, with the support of the international community to reinforce this ownership that has to be taken by the people of South Sudan. Otherwise, I don't see it going. What South Sudan also needs, in spite of all the money that is there with the results of the oil money, is peace building. Peace building is needed. The right type of peace building for small projects, for projects that can really attend to the greater needs of the people. And I think this is where the international community has a role to play. Government, we have to work with the South Sudanese, make them be able to assure that the type of leadership that they have now is not enough. And as has been pointed out in the book, this is a great book. I encourage everyone to read and learn the good lessons that we can so we do not repeat situations like the one in South Sudan. There are other countries where this can also happen. This is where this book is extremely useful, and the timing is also very good one. We just took a very good decision this morning, appointing a new Secretary General who has been very much familiar with situations in South Sudan. He has visited South Sudan time and again. He has visited several other theaters where situations like South Sudan exist. And I hope that we'll be able to pass on to him the lessons in this book as what needs to be done to avoid a situation from, unless we rescue it now, to being irreversible and to being a great disaster for humanity, for all of us here present. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Martins. And I think that the lesson on the need really to drive ownership of the problem among South Sudanese society in order to move forward comes out very clearly from the book. You mentioned, by the way, the Congo War, the earlier Congo War. And I am always struck in that long struggle by a quote that is in a book that Che Guevara wrote about his role and support to that war, where writing back to Fidel Castro at the time and despairing of the way that factionalism within the Congolese opposition movement was destroying the chances of victory in that struggle, he wrote to Fidel Castro, "Comrade, this must be the last time that we give aid unconditionally in such a situation." Which brings perhaps to the comments that we have next from Ian Martin. Ian, of course, not only head now of Security Council report, but a former SRSG in Timor-Leste, in Nepal, in Libya, in other situations. Ian, I hope you might be able to reflect a little bit on the international lessons from this situation.
Yes, I'm going to try to do that. Let me too begin by saying how useful the book is for all of us who are not South Sudan experts and want to understand its problems. It reflects Hilda's decades of involvement with Sudan, and indeed her lifetime experience of Africa, her intense engagement as SRSG. And I know this because while we were working together in the high-level panel on peace operations, she was still carrying out significant further research with sources that very few people have access to. Her concern in the book, rightly, is to tell what she calls the untold story, and not so much to reflect specifically on the lessons for the United Nations. We did a lot of that together, however, in HIPPO. And I'm going to pose four questions, not just to Hilda, to all of us, within the framework of the HIPPO approach. The number one message from HIPPO was the primacy of politics, the need for the information, analysis, and planning to shape United Nations peace operations in a way that was appropriate to context. How far was that done when UNMISS was conceived and planned in 2010? Mm-hmm. The assessment at that time actually specifically said the SPLM would not implode. Alas, that was untrue. But it did say that the key priorities were political. And there were those who argued for a political mission with unarmed military liaison officers and advisors, and not for a mission with formed troops. That discussion in many ways fell prey to the dysfunctional relationship between DPA, from which it largely came, and DPKO. But it was argued because people were concerned not to generate unrealistic expectations and explicitly not to set the United Nations up for failure. And one senior official was quoted as saying, if you send one soldier to South Sudan, you'd better send 100,000. So how far was it right to send a mission that had at the beginning 7,000 troops that the council hoped would be reduced in 3 to 6 months to 6,000 with the kind of blanket mandate to protect civilians that the council has recently enacted? First question. Second question, to move more explicitly to protection of civilians, in HIPPO we very strongly affirm the responsibility of United Nations presences to protect civilians within their capacity, but we also stressed the importance of managing expectations, of carrying out a strategic analysis of the threat to civilians in order to match capabilities and expectations. We certainly said there were no excuses for reluctance on the part of troops who had the responsibility and the capacity to do so, to intervene, to protect civilians. But clearly, in the case of UNMISS, there was no match between capabilities and expectations. There wasn't then, and there isn't now. And does one bridge that gap by raising capabilities, and what is the realistic limit to that, or by recognizing that expectations have to be more realistic? Thirdly, HIPPO emphasized the relationship with the host government because we were concerned not just from South Sudan, but other cases where the relationship between the government and UN peace operations was increasingly tense, if not actively hostile. UNMISS, I think it's true to say, was never the mission that the government of South Sudan wanted. They didn't want a significant military presence, unless it was perhaps to protect their border with Sudan to the north. They certainly didn't want it with a major internal role in protecting civilians. Their mistreatment of UN personnel began very early on. What could and should have been done at the very outset to try to ensure that there was what in HIPPO we called a compact between the receiving government and the United Nations? Where were the responsibilities for that? How far was that a responsibility of the Security Council and member states with the most influence over South Sudan? What could and should have been done at the time? Fourth, to go back even before HIPPO to the Brahimi report, its most quoted line, the Secretariat must tell the Security Council what it needs to know, not what it wants to hear. Reading Hilda's book, you really do feel the mission almost could never have succeeded. You begin with a very trenchant analysis of corruption, and corruption before the mission was there, corruption emerging as soon as the oil was flowing to within the framework of the CPA. But how far was the tone of discussion between the Secretariat and the Council one that reflects the depth of the problems that you've spoken to, Hilda? I'm sure in your private briefings you were tougher than written reports of the Secretary General tend to be. But how adequately did the Security Council respond to a realistic appraisal of the depth of the problems that South Sudan was facing? So let me just roll those four questions forward to today, looking forward rather than looking back. Primacy of politics, where are we now? You talked, Hilda, about the peace agreement being rescued, adjusted. You sounded to me like describing a peace agreement that is to all effects dead and no longer provides a framework and indeed was a flawed agreement. Was it ever realistic to think that the return of Vice President Riek Machar and his troops to Juba, especially as one saw the negotiations over the weaponry that was being brought with them into a Juba that didn't have an effective international security presence, was not going to lead to renewed fighting. Now the Regional Protection Force has been mandated, which is a very different thing from deployed, one might say. What is the prospect of its averting civil war, not just in Juba, but in other parts of the country? Are we not back to a mandate of protecting civilians without a political strategy again? So second, where do we go now on protection of civilians? It really does seem to be mission impossible. The Secretariat has told the Council that 40 to 45% of the troops are now involved in guarding the protection of civilian sites, although even that can't be adequately done, as we've discovered, leaving maybe 30% at most for kind of operational patrolling elsewhere. What now is a realistic approach? Thirdly, what now on host government consent? The Security Council achieved a joint communique with the government accepting the Regional Protection Force. It seems to be going through many layers of acceptance, which makes one question how genuine the buy-in really is to that force and the role that it's supposed to play. But how can one negotiate some genuine understanding between the UN and the government as to its future role? And so finally, in terms of the Security Council's responsibility, which is my current perspective, it seemed to me, Ambassador, that the Security Council immediately after the July crisis was somewhat paralyzed while Washington made up its mind as to what to hand down to you as a draft resolution for your consideration, with at that point at least little strategic discussion in the council. The joint communique during the visit was no doubt an achievement, but the mission did not go any way to address the political framework that would provide a way forward again. I very much hear what you, Ambassador, have said about the arms embargo, but the council has been teetering on the edge of its consideration of an arms embargo for some time while the weaponry has continued to accumulate. Is that now going to go forward? So my final question, I think there's a strategic review team in South Sudan as we speak. Major General Kimert has returned from looking at the protection of civilians issues. Is there now a framework in which the Secretariat and the Council between them are facing up to the seriousness and difficulty of the issues going forward?
Thank you, Ian. And since you put those comments in the form of questions, I'm going to turn directly back to Hilde to comment on the main thrust of those. We have plenty of time for questions and debate afterwards, so we will then go directly to the floor. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you to both speakers and to the chair for elaborating, I think, very well on the challenges. And both lessons learned as well as questions for the way forward. It's hard to respond to all Ian's questions because it's almost a 2 or 3 hour round, but I will try to limit myself to maybe three points that was also linked to, I think the ambassador was underlining the need for lessons learned from UNMISS and from the lessons drawn from South Sudan. I think the one of the main issues it came out very, very strongly also in the HIPAA report and out of my experience. The primacy of politics was not, I think, at the center of the planning process of UNMISS. I know a lot about what went on behind closed doors, but there was certainly a planning process that was much more lengthy and in-depth and field-oriented, interestingly, at the outset, but more focused on the military and the structural issues and not as much on the political ones. I mean, Chris Coleman did a great job with his mandate. He was there in the field for 2 or 3 months, if I'm not mistaken. But the interesting thing is that someone tried to do the right thing, but then when you come back, suddenly internal politics in DPKO and with the council just trumped everything. So nothing that, or very limited elements of what came out of the field-based planning process was then translated into the real findings and mandating actions accordingly. So that was then, a numbers game between Security Council members. And in the midst of all this came UNISFA, so you couldn't afford, even more thousands of troops. So it was, my impression was it was this. And you land on a number. And really a very poor planning process. And also, to my, and I've tried not to be lengthy, but this is a very important point. Mind you that we had, as a UN, been in the country for 6 years, and we got almost everything wrong. Almost everything wrong. And I won't elaborate on all the elements, but I think I can give a justification for that almost everything wrong. So this is a big, big lesson learned about how we do the planning processes. And one of the main reasons, I mean, HIPAA had many field inputs in this regard, but one of the main reasons was the case of UNMISS and a few other important missions where the planning process really didn't work, and that's one of the main reasons for the recommendations in HIPAA. So that's a critical lesson to be learned. But then the question is, What then, in terms of the primacy of politics now? Because what has changed, of course, is since the Security Council took its decision on reinforcing the mission with an RPF, a Regional Protection Force arrangement, which was very important, I think, to do, and it still is. But for that to work effectively, as I said in my intervention, and as comes out very strongly in the HIPAA report, there needs to be a political strategy. So I think that's now the challenge. What does that political strategy look like in a situation where certain elements have changed in terms of power sharing security arrangements? And that has to be thrashed out, I think, in the council and between council members and with the South Sudanese parties. And I think that's now where there's a very critical job that has to be done for us not to risk, you know, having a situation where you don't have a political strategy, but you are deploying into a situation. Of course, for stabilization reasons, it might work, but we also need to be aware of all the constraints that these forces are met with in the South Sudanese context, both logistical and you know, movement and other constraints. Then in terms of, I think, a third point, which also, I think, points to the issue of navigating a very difficult relationship with host governments. Clearly, you know, if there had been a compact implemented at the time, and if there is a compact linked to a political strategy and a deployment today, I think you have a chance where there's mutual accountability on what would be the right, you know, indicators and parameters for the commitment on both sides. I think it's more likely that it can succeed than a situation where you really don't have that. I think it was the ambassador who was highlighting the ownership issue. That is a challenge, but it is linked to the political strategy. And if you don't, in a way, have that that arrangement, it's going to be hard to see it work effectively. And so what I think is key is that both as a lesson learned from the past of unmissed planning, but also as a way forward, I think the compact discussions are, and you know, I know the DPQ is working on this, but are key for finding a way forward in these very, very, I think, murky waters. I think that's maybe the third point I wanted to make, and then I'll limit myself and see what comes from the floor, if I'll build on any of the other points made. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Hilde. Let us go direct to the floor to take comments and questions, please.
John Hirsch from IPI. First of all, thank you all very, very much. I thought this was a terrific panel, and thank you both for your leadership and for this book. And I certainly think you have done absolutely your utmost to not have this situation. So, and with those remarks, Ambassador Princeton Lyman had an article in The Guardian, I think in the last month, essentially suggesting that there should be a transitional administration established by the UN, similar to what was done in Kosovo and East Timor. And you were directly involved in that at the time. And of course, his premise is that these leaders are not acting in good faith, that there's nothing in the attitude or approach of these leaders, the two of them, that suggest that they're going to be amenable to a solution that would bring about a better life for the people of South Sudan. So my question is, what do you make of that? What do you make of his judgment about the devotion of these two leaders to something other than themselves and their groups, and then to the idea of a transitional administration in lieu of this kind of chasing after these guys? Thank you.
Thank you, Ayaka Suzuki from DPKLDFS. many thanks to the speakers. And Hilde, I agree with you about your what you said about the planning process. I was actually on Chris Coleman's team, and I do think that if the findings of that team had translated into the mandate, I think a lot of the issues that Ian pointed out, you know, would have been addressed. But I have a question for you. You concluded that we need to move forward with an adjusted peace agreement, but in particular, pointing to the power sharing arrangements, right? And that we need to work with new leaders from younger generation. This issue also came up at the time when the Commission of Inquiry report was about to come out. And this is kind of a peace and security issue, the sequencing, what should come first. It's always a dilemma facing leaders confronting a situation like the one you found. Security Council faces these situations all the time. At the time, there are many proponents who said that, yes, going back to status quo ante is not an ideal situation, but who else? Who else is there? Who else can command the support of the generals? So knowing what you know now, do you think that that was a moment where this ending impunity and putting justice first would have been the right decision for paving the way for peace in South Sudan? Thanks.
Thanks. One more question. Yes, just at the front over here.
Sure. Alexandra Hinneker with PAX. And you mentioned the need for an inclusive political dialogue in Juba, which, of course, totally agree with. But I was curious if you had any more concrete recommendations about how it would take place, and considering the trouble with the IGAD-led negotiations, who would be best placed to move this forward?
Thank you. Let's come back, Hilde, and then I'll ask Ian and Ambassador Martins if you'd like to come.
A general, I think, comment that cuts across, I think, several of the questions, and that is the limitations of the international community's ability to impose solutions on countries. I think that's a general fact we all are aware of. We don't have a world police, doesn't exist. We can't force our solutions, even if we're the UN, on others. And I think that cuts across all countries in crisis or, you know, about to fall into crisis. That is a challenge and a tension that we have to live with all the time. And that's the challenge, of course, in relation to the point that has been made by Princeton Lyman and Kate Almquist Knopp, who have been the ones proposing the transitional administration by the UN or the AU. Now, Kate is quick to say, and Princeton was with me at Brookings Institute yesterday, so we had the opportunity to explore that discussion a bit, but Kate is quick to say, and she said that in the hearing in the Senate a couple of weeks ago, that this is not about imposing, it's about the country wanting that arrangement. And so that, of course, is a different story. But I do think the challenge is that this is something that that very easily leads to tensions with the countries involved. And I think the experience is different when you have had a recent independence in the case of Timor-Leste and you are asking for help compared to a situation where you've basically imploded as a consequence of a crisis. And so my proposal at the end of my intervention was that one needs to look at a caretaker government that is based on a round table of discussion between all the political forces of South Sudan, and that a caretaker government, I'm not going to go into any detail on how this is to happen. This is my response to your question, who should do it, etc. I don't think that's wise of me. I'm not in that position myself. I'm now just an observer. And so these are issues that the South Sudanese will have to grapple with. But there are certainly people that have thoughts about this, both about how it can be done and by whom and in which way. Now, that then is the, I think, the point I'm making, because then I'm saying also external management of certain sectors might be needed. that, of course, will have to be owned by the South Sudanese as well. I mean, one obvious one is the financial management sector, oil. These are things that can be considered and can be combined with a nationally owned process. And so I think that's a better solution than the solution that has been proposed by my friends. Now, the second point I just wanted to make, I think I've responded to the third, around justice and peace. I'm quite clear, I think, in the book that I do believe in simultaneous processes on justice and peace. I think that always taking the view that this has to be sequential and peace has to come first is not necessarily the right approach. I think this is a case-by-case issue. But it's very important that for South Sudan, the history of the experiences of people basically is that when there hasn't been any form of justice, and that doesn't necessarily have to be only a hybrid court, but also intercommunal ways of providing justice and reconciliation, that there is truth and reconciliation processes that are credible to people. Without that, you get revenge. And what we have seen unfolding in South Sudan is a consequence of atrocities made way before 91. I mean, there's a whole series of events in South Sudanese lives where the conflicts that are now erupting almost all over the country have their roots in previous violations of human rights and previous atrocities. So if you don't address it, you are getting into a cycle of violence, which I think is what South Sudan is experiencing now. So my view and what I'm saying in the book is, if you don't address the justice issues, you are producing and reproducing conflict going forward in the country. Now, the question is how, when, in which way? And I think the peace agreement provides for a clear roadmap on the justice and reconciliation side. And it's very clear that from the AU Commission of Inquiry, that this is something that shouldn't wait for ages. It's something that should be addressed. And so I think that that is a view I support. And I think a view the Security Council supported in its last resolution. Thank you.
Ambassador Martin, Sorian.
Well, I would like to say that, well, unfortunately, the Trusteeship Council, today it's only a room at United Nations, doesn't exist anymore. I think today we need, now that the right to self-determination has been exercised, there is an independent country, there is this fight going on, this has to be solved inside by the Sudanese by forcing the need for dialogue. And this, the African Union has been playing an important role. I think there is a need for more internal discussion on the way forward to take place between the regional organization and, of course, the United Nations itself, including ourselves, the Security Council. We need to empower the South Sudanese in finding solutions to South Sudanese problems. If you see it being done from the outside, it doesn't work. Now, is it doable? I think it is possible. I think they have come to a point where the violence has gone so much far that cannot go beyond unless the country will implode. And I think there is something that the South Sudanese have to, to realize. I have met so many South Sudanese who believe that they are ready for a new day. And that new day has to be something that needs to be realized. And the workings has to be done internally. I fully agree, DPKO and DPA, please do more political analysis of the situation. This is not a country where you cannot, how many more troops can you bring in to do protection of civilians? The protection of civilians has to be done by the South Sudanese, not by troops coming from elsewhere who are seen, unfortunately, we need to work on these relationships. And the way is to definitely pass the responsibility to South Sudanese. They are responsible. Riek Machar and Salva Kiir are not the only ones there. There are more people there. There are more leaders there. We need to discover the leaders internally and empower them to be able to seek solutions and bring solutions to the problems in the country. That, to me, the way forward.
Thank you, Ambassador Matthews. Ian?
Just one quick further word to reinforce the national ownership point. A transition administration was possible in East Timor because there was a Timorese leadership that wanted, saw the need for and wanted a period of international transitional administration. Even then, I may tell you that the tensions between national control and international control of decision-making emerged very, very quickly. And just to say that in general, I think the Timor-Leste presents more points of contrast than of parallels with South Sudan, I mean, in terms of the depth of the problems. But just to talk about what happened when Timor-Leste did implode in May 2006, and when I was a special envoy of the Secretary General doing what could be done perhaps to help, the real mediation in that dispute was done by José Ramos Horta, to tell you the truth, by one of the national leaders who avoided becoming part of a division in the leadership and helped the leadership to come back together again.
Before we go back for a further round of questions, I just add to this issue of the transitional administration, and I think the panel really put a nail in the coffin of this as an idea for the solution. I think it is also well worth thinking that in the two situations, Timor-Leste and Kosovo, where this has been entrusted recently, not only were people calling for it, but these were also very small countries. And yet, despite that, to be very honest, the UN and the international community had a very hard time in administering them effectively.
I think
the chances that anyone internationally could effectively administer South Sudan, I think one can probably fairly say, are close to zero. But
thank you for saying that.
Just come back. At the back.
Thank you. George Baumgarten from the UN Press Corps. I find it interesting that you're talking about using phrases like interim UN administration and even, horror of horrors, trusteeship council, which, as somebody mentioned, for all intents and purposes, hasn't existed in some decades.
I think the panel were, however, all saying that this was not an appropriate solution in this case.
There's a basic difference between this country and those other two countries. Kosovo and Timor-Leste were not independent at the time that the UN became involved. This is a country that's been independent, quote, independent, end quote. Dubious independence, but independence just the same. Independent enough to have their flag across the street for 5 years. And how do you stare a South Sudanese leader, how do you stare any South Sudanese citizen straight in the face and tell them, well, we gave you your independence, you achieved your independence, now we've sort of got to take it back? That's the question I have to any of you.
It's to one of the points that Hilde had made earlier. Just, we have other, yes, please, over here.
Thank you. My name is Mel Duncan from Nonviolent Peace Force. There's already been several references to Chris Coleman's report in 2010 that would have sent unarmed advisors. And as both Ian and Hilda know, the HIPPO report emphasizes that at the forefront of UN efforts to protect civilians shall be unarmed approaches. And so what about sending in more unarmed civilian protectors who can play a role both protecting civilians as they are in POC areas and at the same time supporting those local peace-building efforts that will be so essential? I also want to point out that in talking about this new emerging generation that will bring the change, it's very important to emphasize that there are a significant number of younger women who are part of that emerging group.
Thank you. And a question behind?
Albert Trittart with IPI. So my question goes back a bit into the territory of your previous book. The CPA was essentially an agreement between the government of Sudan in the north and the SPLA in the south, and didn't so much address other conflicts within the north and within the south. I was wondering if you think that might have set the stage for the current conflict in the south, whether there's anything that could have been done differently, and what lessons that could offer for future negotiations or power sharing arrangements within South Sudan.
Thank you.
Dennis Bennett, I've been involved in South Sudan since 1998. I'm just curious on why it appears, and there may be more back channel things I'm not aware of, why it appears that the peacekeeping efforts didn't reach out to the elders of the tribes of both Dinka and the Ware, rather than just the leaders. Because in my experience out in the bush, the elders have the power. They're not visible usually, but they're there. And they held the power that the chiefs don't.
Thanks. I think we have time just for a couple more comments or questions if people have them, and then we'll go back to the panel.
Yeah. Okay.
Good. All right. It got landed on you.
That's okay. I think we were very clear on the trusteeship. All representatives on this panel were clear that this is not a viable option for South Sudan. And I think we all made substantiated comments on why this is the case. And so I think that has been already answered. I think the second point on unarmed civilian protectors. During the time pre-crisis, when we still, I mean, having been SRSG during the pre-crisis time is not right to see pre-crisis because there was continuous crisis management all the time, and I think I'm showing that in the book, but at least pre-war, although there were conflicts around. The issue of unarmed civilian protectors was one of the things that we looked at, and this was also something we, as a HIPPO panel, explored, actually, and did include in one of our recommendations. I think in that environment in Jonglei, that would have been certainly worth using and exploring. I think in the current environment in South Sudan, where the insecurity levels are so significant, I'm not sure it's going to work. Maybe around the POC sites, I mean the protection of civilian sites, it could work. I think at this point in time, it's such a nasty security situation that I think it's going to be hard to see this be a way forward. I mean, it may be one thing that can complement others in certain cases, but I don't think it's really an avenue that would be, I think, help alleviate the situation in any significant way at this point in time, because it's so it's so bad. Now, the question around the CPA. And how it was not addressing, I think you were saying, other conflicts in the north and in the south. It's not entirely correct. The northern conflicts were in Nuba Mountains and Blue Nile, and they were an ABIE. They were subject to three different protocols in the agreement. And was strenuously negotiated, I have to say. The only conflict that erupted during the negotiations was Darfur. That was repeatedly, you know, pushed for to be included in the CPA process. Khartoum did not want that. But I'm saying that in another book that I'm publishing in Norway on Monday, which is on this in Norwegian, that has been, I think, documented in different contexts. The South Sudan issues, I mean, there's been an also an indirect or direct reference in the Commission of Inquiry by the African Union. There's a criticism of CPA on this issue, and particularly that that the CPA should have included, you know, South-South negotiations or dialogue between South-South communities. I think, in all modesty, I will say it would never have worked. Sorry for saying that, but I have been present in those negotiations. It's just too complex to include multiple conflicts in one negotiation framework. I think that it could not have worked, and the strategy by the leadership of the South at this point in time, when Dr. Garang was still alive, was to do a sequential process. So you do the CPA first, and then you proceed with internal South-South dialogue during and on the side in parallel. So there was South-South dialogue taking place by the SPLA leadership alongside the negotiations. And then subsequently, you would have this National Conference of National Reconciliation, which would bring all of the South Sudanese forces together. So that was the idea, and it partly happened. But it did, as very often happens in South Sudan, it collapsed again, and you had to renegotiate. And I think the issue of South-South and inclusiveness related to ethnic tensions as well as militia is a recurrent problem in South Sudan. I don't think you can resolve it once and for all, unfortunately. It will continue to be a question of tension, and it needs a huge generational 10-20 years effort, which is following the national reconciliation process. It has to be very credibly led for these things to be sorted out. Then for inclusiveness in the CPA, we did push quite hard to get other actors in the table, all the political forces. We didn't succeed. None of the parties wanted any others at the table, naturally, because it reduces their power. I mean, it's obvious. So you have the choice. Either you deal with the ones at the table, or you drop the whole negotiation altogether. For us, this conflict was such a big one for the African continent. It was the longest civil war in Africa. It was better to try to get a deal with those who were willing to negotiate than to drop the thing because we couldn't get everyone. So this is just a matter of decision that you have to make. And in the end, it's the parties, and it's the parties and the two warring parties that decide the framework. The international community can't push. Again, this is about the imposing thing. Yeah. To believe that we and the international community, the Troika, is designing a peace process. No, we can't do that. These are people that are designing it all by themselves. We can push and shove and, you know, do our best. But in the end, the decision is theirs, and we can't impose it. And for anyone knowing South Sudanese and South Sudanese, you can't impose anything on them, nor on most other populations and ethnic groups in the world. Then on the issue, I think, of the Dinka Nua and the elders, are 2 points. One, we did bring in faith-based leaders. We did talk to the elders quite a lot during the period up to the conflict broke out. Following the civil war, the elders didn't have much influence. We can now bring them to the table, I think. It's more likely that they can have an influence now than before. But for one, if there's one force that has been fueling the conflict, it is the Dinka Council of Elders. The GN Council of Elders has been constantly fueling the conflict and has not been conducive to peace. Now, the question is, will that change? I really hope so. So it's not always the case that if they are the true representatives of all the Dinka groups, that is a question that I don't think I should enter into. But certainly the most organized of them is this group. And that has been a big problem. And it has ethnicized the conflict even further. So I think those are my comments on these issues. I'll have 2 words at the very end, maybe. Yeah.
Please, Ambassador Martins.
I would like just to say that as extremely and very difficult the situation seems to be, I am now seeing just, you know, a light at the end of the tunnel in Sudan. First, the signing of the peace agreement, followed by the recent visit by the Council and the joint communique which was signed. It is a form of passing the responsibility for the solution to the South Sudanese themselves. because the agreement was signed with the council involving that peace force to establish some degree of stability in the country, which is needed for anything positive to be done. I think this has to be followed by a very sensitive political analysis of the situation. I am also, I like that idea of the elders and the civil society. Look at the role of the Roman Catholic Church. It has become the place where people assemble to run away from being killed. So they had a protection element in itself. So I think there is a need for the involvement of all these internal elements and forces with the assistance of the international community, with some elements of peace building. I remember when we were discussing some of the resolutions, one of the things that when we were talking about the need for sanctions and all the rest, what they were saying, we also need peace building. This is what we were being told by the representatives of the South Sudanese. It is a way of extending a hand to a country, to a government, to a population which needed the external assistance to be able to pass the message very clearly that responsibility for solution, that's you. There must be, we must put an end to this, the level of conflict that still exists between the international community and local, South, Sudanese. There must be dialogue. We must be seen as working together towards the same end. That, to me, is what is required, essentially for us to move forward out of this. Look, there was resistance even in accepting this, regional protection force by the government of South Sudan. They didn't want it to be done. It was a need to sort of impose. But then it was not seen as an imposition, but seen as something needed, as an assistance for looking together for the solutions we need. And I think if we continue like this, then I can say that I do see a light at the end of the tunnel. The region has to be seriously engaged. And as I have said, there's going to be yet another summit of the Great Lakes region, and South Sudan is going to be key on the agenda, so that the region also should be seen as doing what is required to move this agenda forward together with the United Nations, DPKO, DPA, of course, the new Secretary General. Well, it's going to take at least 3 more months, but once he comes, I'm sure it's going to be yet another element that we have to take into account to keep the hope that South Sudan can be turned back to peace. Thank you.
Yeah. That's a better last word than mine, but let me just quickly respond to Mel Duncan on unarmed protection strategies, because I think Mel, I'm very much in favour of doing the maximum that can be done, both within a UN framework and outside it in that respect. But I do think we have to be careful between thinking that at some point unarmed and armed protection are alternatives to each other. There comes a point at which one has to answer the question, do we or do we not want there to be an international military capability on the ground to intervene in a situation of killings of civilians? And if so, to what extent, with what capacity, what are the limits of its feasibility? What are the long-term consequences, not just the short-term consequences? And those are very difficult questions. UN peacekeeping was not invented as something to intervene in tribal warfare. You know? And yet we've reached a point where there's almost an expectation that, that any such situation is one that needs to be addressed through international military means. If there is major electoral violence in the DRC, where there's a mission deployed for a completely different reason, does that mean that it is a peacekeeping responsibility to intervene to prevent electoral violence? I don't think sufficient thought has been given as we've gone from saying peacekeepers must not stand idly by, as in Rwanda or at Srebrenica, to an almost blanket mandate and expectations emanating from the Security Council, and sometimes encouraged by the humanitarian community. And we need to wrestle further with this question in South Sudan, but also elsewhere.
Thank you. I'm going to give the very, very last word to Hilde, but just to say that this is obviously a momentous day for the UN in many ways. Aside from this event, there was some other news this morning, as has been mentioned. And I very much hope that the type of debriefing and questioning and probing what could be done that we have just done in this session becomes part of how the UN does business under the new Secretary General, and that we can really draw on this kind of book, this kind of reflection, to inform those strategies. Hilde, the last word is yours.
Yeah, so for your next discussions, I might suggest a couple of topics. One that comes out maybe not explicitly as much in my book, but that is coming out of a lot of the discussions around South Sudan these days, is also, is it possible for UN peacekeepers to confront government forces in any significant way in relation to the protection of civilians and in relation to situations that we've seen? This is a big question that is never discussed openly, because it's a very complicated one. But it is, in a way, it's an issue I would like to leave with you, because it is important to discuss it. The other that is directly related to South Sudan at this point in time is the country is collapsing economically. And the link between the economic impact and war and conflict is huge. The soldiers are without salaries. The predatory practices on civilians is unbelievable. And it is in itself the connection between when an economy, when the country goes bankrupt, what happens to security, safety, the fabric of society. That also has security aspects to it that I think also is unexplored in the UN. We look at only the politics of this, but we should also look at the economics of it. So leave those two issues with you. And then thirdly, I just wanted to make a quick point at the very end. And just to say that we have been emphasizing national ownership. We have been emphasizing not to impose things. At the same time, I do want to highlight the South Sudanese leaders cannot be left to their own devices. This is not going to lead anywhere. So at the same time as there has to be, a sense of ownership on charting the way forward, there's an absolute clear responsibility on the international community, and in particular the region. We haven't discussed IGAD and the AU as much here, but I think absolutely the region will have a critical role to play. And I think the political transition that somehow has to be charted here, I think the region will have a key role. So I wanted to just end there, because I don't want people to leave with a sense of leaving this like that. The international community and the UN and the AU and IGAD has a huge task at their hands in making this happen and in rescuing the peace agreement, which I think still has to be rescued, but it has to then be fit for charting the road and the way forward. So that's my last word. Thank you.